Now, our first next guest, a first shot to fame as one of the Spice Girls, but with solo album sales of 3 million and writing credits on an incredible 11 number ones, she's one of the country's leading female solo artists of the last decade. It is, of course, Melanie C. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
Now, you're going to be playing a new song, Better Alone, for us later as an acoustic version.
Yes.
Why is that?
Well, you know what?
Couldn't be bothered with the heavy equipment.
I think it's easier for you guys. But, you know, it's nice to do things acoustically as well. It gives people, you know, just a glimpse at what else you're capable of. And there's no room for error when it's acoustic. It's all very quiet and everything's very exposed.
It's quite a powerful song, that, Better Alone. Just what is it about?
Well, this song, it is probably one of the most personal songs on the album. And it's from quite a specific situation, that something that happened to me. And really, it's a bit of an emotional journey, this song. It starts out, you know, feeling quite vulnerable and being let down and feeling disappointment. But then as the song goes on, you know, the confidence builds. And really, the song's about growing up, standing on your own 2 feet and becoming independent.
So as a songwriter, if you have a period of really happy life, that must be quite difficult for you, because you need some angst to write about, don't you?
That's the thing. All the good times are tainted with, you know, worrying about writer's block.
So when you're singing this song, it doesn't bring the bad times back, does it, that you wrote about?
Not at all. You know, one thing that I've found over the years, because obviously, you know, you write songs and you get to perform them hundreds and hundreds of times, and it reminds you of that memory, but then also you reinforce your strength and your feeling and what you've gained, really, from writing
angry,
the song.
Yeah. I wouldn't mess with you in this situation.
Oh, no, wouldn't I? I'm a fly.
Now, tell us about the papers. You've been looking through the week's papers for us. What have you picked
out? I have, actually. The first story here, it's about the 2 minute silence we had in London. But not only in London, actually, it was acknowledged in cities and countries all over the world. Of course, you know, it was for the dreadful events that happened the week previously in London, and I happened to be in central London the day of the silence. I'm actually really pleased I was there. I think it's something I'll never forget.
It is amazing when a city draws to a halt like this. I mean, it just wasn't, you know, occasional observers. This is a city coming completely to a halt, like we see now. Look at the people standing in the street.
It was incredible. I don't think that London has ever come to a standstill like this before. And I felt very proud. I felt very proud to be British and, you know, really just show our solidarity and, you know, just to show our thoughts and feelings and that they're with the people that have been affected.
Did this help, do you think? Just coming to a halt for 2 minutes, did that help?
You know what? I think it's really important. I think it's really important to acknowledge that, you know, we are all in this together. We're not going to be beaten. And also just to remember, because life does go on, and it would be terrible if we just, you know, if people felt like it had been forgotten.
But life goes on, but a different life goes on, kind of after this, doesn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
Have you noticed a difference in London?
Yeah, there's been quite a lot of differences, really. I think there was a lot of fear. You know, you could feel fear on the streets a few days after the event. But, you know, also the feeling of defiance and strength. And you know that people in London are often criticised from being a pretty unfriendly bunch. But
well, part of that cuts into the next story, doesn't it, about cycle safety?
Yeah, I mean, this is something I've noticed, because I drive in and around London. And in fact, I have cycled through central London. Wow, that is scary in itself. And
17,000 injuries a year. On cyclists,
really?
Yeah, in London.
Well, Ken Livingstone, come on, use that congestion charge money wisely and make it safer for cyclists.
Because this newspaper story is saying about how many cycles have been sold since the bombing. I mean, people actually coming out of the tubes and the buses and getting onto bikes.
Well, you know, another thing that's, you know, bad, obviously, about this, I mean, the whole public transport thing is an issue in itself. But people are back more in cars, I've noticed. Congestion's back up. People are cycling. But I found incredible, a bike shop that sells 30 bikes a day are selling nearly 100 bikes a day now.
Do you think drivers have been more considerate to cyclists? Because I remember in New York after 9/11, people said that they waved with 5 fingers instead of 2 at fellow motorists and stuff. Do you think people actually take more notice of cyclists now?
Yeah, I think something like this. I mean, obviously with the cyclists, when there's more of them, they're easier to see. But even motorists with each other, I think everybody's been, you know, a bit more tolerant of each other.
And quite a considerable environmental impact, really, there, which brings us on to this next story about food being transported.
And
just tell
again,
us about this.
And both of them with health issues, you know, get on your bike, get fit. Obesity is a big problem in this country also. Yeah, but this one is really about the environmental cost of transporting food. Food miles have kind of, it's kind of been a quite a negative thing, you know, food that's transported to us, because now, you know, we want produce all year round. We don't just want seasonal things. Everything is made available to us. And for a long time, they're saying that the environmental impact of that is quite bad. But now they're saying, you know, the tomato, for example, to grow a tomato in the UK is detriment to the environment. Exactly, yeah. But you know, personally, for me, I'm a big supporter in local produce, supporting farmers. I'm a big believer in organic foods. And you know, at the end of the day, you know, food is very important to us as human beings, and it's about really the nutritional benefits of having fresh food. And when you're getting stuff locally, it's so much better for you.
Now, talking about being better for you, you're a big vitamin fan, aren't you?
I am.
This next story is about the EU changes to vitamins.
Yeah, I mean, I take vitamins, bit of a vitamin junkie at times, but I do feel the benefits of vitamins.
And what's this about exactly?
This is, well, there's an EU directive that they're trying to pass through court at the moment. They're trying to restrict the sales of vitamins and mineral pills.
I think it's been passed, isn't it, now?
It has been passed.
Because the regulations come into force
next month.
Absolutely.
And I know. My feelings on this, and I think a lot of the alternative, you know, health community are quite paranoid about this. Is it to protect the public, or is it to protect the profits of pharmaceutical companies?
And is your bathroom shelf loaded with vitamin pills?
They're in my kitchen.
Kitchen. But you've got a big array of them, so you're a believer.
I do, yeah. And, you know, and I think they help. You know, especially because life's tough, you know. We demand a lot from our lives, I mean, from ourselves, from our bodies. And, you know, and it just helps. Best to get them from food, as we all know. But, you know, a little bit of help here and there.
A helping hand. Now, also, this final story is great. It comes from grannies in Margate in Kent who want to wear hoodies and make them untrendy.
This really is. This is the best story. Yeah, down in Margate, some grannies have got together, started wearing hoodies. To really try and put the kids off wearing them. But I've got a plea to these grannies. I would really love you to blast out the crazy frog from your bungalows in the hope that kids will start buying it.
Put it in one of those tartan trolleys they take shopping. Yeah, put a little ghetto blaster in there and playing that, and that'll make it really uncool. They do look fantastic, though, don't they? And one of them was saying they're actually elbowed by a teenager in the street because he was so annoyed about
this. Well, you know, poor kids, they get blamed for everything now, don't they? But, you know, I do have to admit, I mean, they can be quite intimidating. And wearing, you know, stuff like this, they don't want to be caught, do they, on CCTV doing the naughty stuff. So.
And the grannies as well.
Yeah.
Be a granny crime wave after that. Well, Melanie, thank you for looking at the papers for us. You're playing Better Alone for us acoustically later.
Yeah.
And Anita, Melanie has asked me to play air guitar all the way through that, so I'm practising now.
Max, you are the only man I know who could do that out of tune as well.
It's perfectly in tune. It's
Melanie,
working.
You have no idea what you've unleashed at all. But yes, we'll be listening to that later, and I do look forward to that very much. Still to come on the Heaven and Earth
show.
Before we go, though, earlier we did promise you a performance from Melanie C, and so we don't break our promises. Here she is now with a special acoustic version of her new single, Better Alone. Max, if you even try that guitar, you're in trouble.
See you next week.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Understand your point of view, letting me go, but I thought you had more faith. Everything I've done for you, you made the mistakes, and now you throw this in my face. And I have worked so hard for you all of this time, and you cast me aside. I understand your point of view, but I can't seem to get head around all the things that I feel good about, always seem to disappear. And every time I think I've got this all worked out, something chews me up and spits me out, but there's nothing left to fear. I'm better alone, my dear. Setting me free. It's really amazing the changes I'm starting to feel. You still have me. Will I ever get my head around all the things that I feel good about that always seem to disappear? When every time I think I've got this all worked out, something chews me up and spits me out, but there's nothing left to do.